Hello, my friends, and welcome to this week's edition of the Q&A. Our first question comes from Avery, and he asks, is tracking your macros a viable way to lose weight and gain muscle? And I'm not just going to say yes, but I'm going to say hell yes. And the reason that I'm going to say that is because the more scientific you can get about your fitness, the better. And tracking numbers is quantitative science, and that's what losing weight is all about. You have to be good at numbers. Well, you don't have to be amazing, you just kind of have to be good. You know, you just have to have passed math 12 with a 50. In fact, you don't. You probably only need your grade 9 math, to be honest with you. But the thing is this, if you have a number that you are trying to hit for the day, and you know that you can't go above that number, you're going to spend the entire day in your subconscious mind thinking about that, where, okay, cool, I can't go above this. So if you're trying to lose weight, gain muscle, you're going to need 1.6 to 1.8 grams of protein per day, per kilogram of body weight. I know that doesn't really make a lot of sense, it's logical, but it's whatever. That's what the data says, and that's what you need to eat. Because beyond that, you're going to notice a drop-off in effects of muscle retention and actual muscle gain if you just eat, you know, 300, 400 grams of protein a day if you don't need it. And carbs, I seriously think that you have to keep that at an absolute maximum at all times. Whether you're bulking or cutting, you really need to keep your carbs up. And the reason for that is because when your carbs are low, you have less energy. And when you have less energy, you can't perform maximally. And when you can't perform maximally on a daily basis in the gym, you're going to notice a drop-off in your absolute strength. You're going to notice a drop-off in your one rep max. But you have to keep your fats on track too, because if you don't, you're going to experience hormonal crashes. If you do a no-fat diet, not only are you going to have a gallbladder attack, but you're probably not going to be able to get an erection. You're probably not going to wake up with that, you know, testosteronous attack the day sort of attitude. And that's why you need to keep your fats up. And also, if you're not producing testosterone, I mean, this isn't going to happen. So you need to have your fats, you need to have your cholesterol. Avoid trans fats at all costs, saturated fats. That's a whole nother topic for a different day, but I would say keep it around 20 to 30% of your diet should be fats. Make sure that you're getting the minimum amount that you need for your body weight. So the next question is from Matt, who asks, what's the best way to exercise so that you don't hurt your knees after you've been at work all day? And what I'm going to say is, it may seem counterproductive, but what you need to do is you need to do more squats. Seriously. If you've been on your feet all day, and I have done 8-hour days, 5 days a week, for months at a time during my summer work placements, and I have experienced that, but you're going to need to do two things. You're going to need to squat more often. The reason that I say that is because you're going to have to strengthen your quadriceps and your hamstrings and your calves, really. And what that's going to do is it's going to give you more endurance when you're actually at work so that you don't get as tired when you come home. The other thing that I'm going to try to get you to do is to stretch your quadriceps after you come home from work. So the other reason that I say that you need to squat more often is because you'll get more practice in squatting. And when you get more practice, if you're thinking about this consciously, you're going to get better form with squats. And basically, yeah, when you get better with your form, you're going to notice that that fatigue starts to go away now that your legs are stronger. So Jared asks on Facebook, what are the benefits of a wide grip and a close grip in terms of rows, and how would you apply them in a routine? When it comes to rows, and really any form of barbell exercise, I don't recommend usually that you do a wider grip. And the reason for that is because it puts more strain in your shoulders. In fact, I don't think you should be putting your shoulders into any sort of position where they're vulnerable. So we have two serious mistakes here. We have a wide flare. So if you're doing some rows like this, that's not going to do anything, right? That's going to do your rear delts, really, and maybe your traps. That's not how you do a row. So the way that you want to do a row is at shoulder width. the reason that you might want to consider going narrower is to get a better stretch. Because when you get a better stretch, the muscle's going to work more through a wider range of motion. But either way, what you want to do is you want to have your hands so that you can retract your scapula and pull it to your chest or pull it to your belly button. And that's the thing, you can either pull it to right about here on your sternum or to your belly button. If you pull it to your sternum, it's going to get more of the upper back. The belly button, you're going to get more lower lats. If you're working through a full range of motion, you should find that if you're doing rows and some form of pull-up or lat pull-down, you'll be making maximum development in your back muscles. So our next question comes from Jamal, who asks, what are some variations of squats and deadlifts for a 6'7" man? And this may seem like I'm just being facetious, but it's true. You just need to do conventional deadlifts and squats the normal way that you would do them, because it's literally the same movement for everybody. And I realize that there are some obvious mechanical differences between somebody who's short and stocky like me versus somebody who's, you know, super tall like you. But what I'm going to recommend is that you do conventional deadlifts. You learn the basic maneuver of the conventional deadlift. And then if it feels better for you, I would recommend that maybe you try the sumo deadlift. Now basically what that is you put your, instead of putting your hands just outside your legs, your feet are positioned outside near the plates. Not on them, not anywhere really near them so that they might fall on your feet. But they're a wider stance. And what you do with your hands, you can usually do either a hook grip or a mixed grip or just a regular overhand, double overhand grip. Just grab the bar sort of almost near the middle, near the center of gravity. Not right in the middle, but you want to have your hands basically closer than they normally would be on a conventional deadlift. As far as the squat's concerned, I would recommend that you do the low bar back squat. That's what I recommend that everybody do. Or the front squat. The front squat is a very useful variant, and I think it definitely has its place in bodybuilding, in strength training. But I really feel as though the low bar back squat is the easiest form of the squat to perform, and it also uses the maximum amount of muscle recruitment. So Logan asks, how far can you go without using weights and relying solely on your own body mass for training? And, you know, that's a really valid question, because there are a lot of people who simply do calisthenic workouts. There are some very fit guys that you can go Google who have created amazing bodies only using calisthenics. Now, when we come to the issue of doing things maximally, you're going to want to have a gym. And the reason that I say that is because there is a strength component to making muscular development. So let me illustrate something for you. If, under all things remaining equal, let's say I'm doing bench press, right? So I have a 135-pound barbell, and I'm just doing regular bench press for 5 sets of 5. You have that barbell, and you're doing the bench press, but you would be making more muscle gains if you're doing the exact same set of repetitions, the exact same exercise, the exact same way, for the exact same amount of sets, if you had 165 pounds on the barbell. So I guess what I'm trying to illustrate here is that you are limited by how much you weigh. And in order to get better at some of these bodyweight exercises, you're going to have to start to weigh less. So you're severely limited by your own body mass in that regard. However, you can make good progress doing it, but you'll just have to realize that it's not maximal. Okay, so, Logan, let's make a very contrasted illustration for you here. Let's say that you're just doing bodyweight squats, and you're doing them for sets of 30. Well, what if, instead of doing that, you're doing low bar back squats with 275 pounds on your back plus your body weight, and you were moving that through a range of motion, through an appreciable range of motion? That's going to train your nervous system a lot more than doing body weight squats with sets of 30. The guy who's got the weight advantage is, well, he's gonna have an advantage. And the reason for that is also because of this. He can add weight to that bar whenever he wants. And if there's a day where he's fatigued, well, he can just take off some of the weight, no big deal. And so that way you can train your nervous system for purely strength if you need to. You cannot do that simply by doing body weight exercises. But that being said, you can train to a certain extent, to the extent of you becoming a very aesthetic person through bodyweight exercises. Alright, so our next question comes from Roderick, who asks, for somebody who has not worked out before or has not done anything properly, how much weight is right for them to start at? Now, what you have to consider is this. If we're going to do this scientifically, which we should be doing, you need to go find out what your 100% is. So what I would do is go into a gym, if you have that available to you, find out what your one rep max is, because that way we can determine what the 85%, what the 70% of that number actually is. Now, when it comes to finding out, do you use 70%, do you use 85%, do you use 90%, you need to find a strength training program. Now, luckily for you guys out there, I have those available. Just send me a message on YouTube or on Facebook. I'll get back to you. But if that's not an option to you, go find it on the internet. There are some really great ones that are out there that are free. You should be training with either anywhere from 70 to, I'd say the upper limit of that would be 90% of your one rep max. Now, the higher percentage you go, the lower reps you're going to be doing. So if you're doing 90%, threes. Just do sets of three. Now the thing with that is that can hamper your recovery ability, because that can lead to some connective tissue damage. But we do strength training programs that have sets of three for limited amounts of time. And the reason that we do that is to prime the nervous system to be ready for a new 100%. Now, if you wanted to do a more aesthetic bodybuilding sort of approach, I'd go with anywhere from 70 to 80% of your one rep max for higher reps. So that could be anywhere from 5 sets of 5 to 4 sets of 8, 4 sets of 10, 3 sets of 12, that sort of thing. And I guess some more tips for starting training. Contact me, get in touch with your boy. The other thing that you really need to do is you gotta have staying power. So my first 6 months in the gym were actually pretty bad. I didn't make a whole lot of progress, but I knew that if I stuck with it, I could attain my goals. And I mean, it worked out. I would say that if you're going to be starting out, don't listen to people in gyms. Do not listen to them at all. The internet knows better than Joe Schmo, who doesn't do squats anymore because he threw his back out and thinks that he knows about squats. So unless you're talking to a personal trainer, or perhaps somebody who is a seasoned powerlifter, do not take any advice from people who are actually just in the gym, because you don't know who they are. 99% of the time, they don't have any sort of even basic academic understanding of human anatomy. Stay away from steroids until you at least, I would stay away from them forever, but if you're going to do them, I don't recommend that you do, but if you do, wait. Wait until you have reached the natural limit of your potential, because that's when you need it. That's when you should do it, if you're going to, which you shouldn't. But anyway. So Caitlin asks, what's the best way to relax or heal yourself the day after a workout? One of the biggest things that you can do is self-massage, or, you know, get your man to do a little massage on you, sort of thing. Putting mechanical tension on a muscle, if it's injured, can be an issue, but if it's just micro tears, yeah. If you're really sore the day after, if you get somebody to massage you, it'll make you feel better. Another way of doing it by yourself is having a foam roller. You can get them for about, I think, $20 or less at most retail stores. So this here is a foam roller. Basically what you do is, you can look up tutorials on YouTube, you can look up mine, which is going to be out soon. So basically you take this, you leave it on a wall or on the floor, and you, let's say you want to do your back, you roll up and down, and you put pressure against it this way. Perfect thing for doing a little self-massage. You can also get those little rollers or those little the little balls that kind of stick into your muscles. Those are great. Another thing that you can try to do is have a warm shower. That usually helps with connective tissue stress, I mean. And you have, even better, a warm bath with Epsom salts. Another big thing is stretching. I'm going to do a stretching video pretty soon. You just have to basically stretch the muscles that you've contracted while you were training. So the last question of the week is from my very good friend Matt Clamp, who asks, what is a good way to not rip the skin when you're doing deadlifts? And basically you use somebody else's chalk when you are doing the deadlifts. And basically when you're at home, you can take one of these right here. It's just a nail clipper, and you're gonna have to manage your calluses. Now once they get really thick, just go ahead, and I got one right here that I can show you. This is gonna be disgusting. Viewer discretion is advised. Okay, we got our callus right here. Focus. So, boom, that's going to come right off, okay? And you just do that till the whole callus is gone. So, on deadlifts, yeah, you can rip your hands open pretty easily. Just make sure that your calluses don't get out of whack, and you're taking care of your calluses, and you're using chalk. So, my friends, that is it for this week. If I helped you at all, make sure to like the video, make sure to share it with your friends. And if you ever need any sort of training, any sort of advice, give me a message. If you need a strength training program, if you need an aesthetics program, come see me, whether you're an athlete, aspiring bodybuilder, fitness enthusiast, weightlifter, whatever it is, I have the program for you. So until next week, take care, and peace be with you.